guys. Thank you everyone for coming. Today I'll be speaking about my latest work on the naked firewalls. I apologize for my voice. I kind of lose my voice a couple days ago. It's has not completely recovered. But I hope you can hear me. So this talk is based on this paper in collaboration with Peace In Chun, Don Page, Misao Sasaki, and Don Han Yong. It was put on the archive last November. So this is basically the talk outline. I'll start with some background review to explain what is a firewall. And the thing is that everyone has a different interpretation and different understanding of what a firewall could be and what a firewall is. So this is solely based on my understanding of that. And then I'll talk about the main issue that we studied in this paper, which is the issue of the location of the firewall and our assumption for the firewall, the causality assumption, to determine where it could be. And then I'll explain the quantum fluctuation to the event horizon, which will lead to the firewall becoming naked. By naked, we mean that observers outside of the black hole determine that there is such a thing as a firewall without falling in. And then I'll explain why this means firewall is problematic phenomena if it truly exists. And then I'll make some remark about other horizon estimates that was used to study the location of the firewall. So now I'll review what is a firewall. First of all, let me set the stage. We'll study only the Schwarzschild solution. So just the whole Schwarzschild, there's no charge or rotation. And it's all asymptotic being flat, not ABS or zero space or anything. So just very simple geometry. Now let me make a remark on distinction between event horizon and apparent horizon. Now, if you consider light rays that travel on now 26 all the way to future now infinity, in the Penrose diagram, this now future infinity, denoted by square plus. Now, a black hole is then a region from which light cannot escape. In the mathematical form, this term divided. So, it's a whole space time manifold. Take out the course of path of the square plus. So the event horizon is then the boundary of this part of space time. One important remark is that event horizon is theological. So what does this mean is that we need to know the entire future of the space time in order to determine where the event horizon is. So it depends on the knowledge of the entire space time. Why is this a case? Consider, for example, the formation of a black hole from the collapse of a null shell. This is a collapse of a star. This is a collapse of the null shell. So the event horizon is R equals to 2m, determined by the mass of the energy of the null shell. However, note that this R equals to 2m horizon is it already formed, say, at this point, before the null shell comes in. Okay. So the observer at this point is already inside a black hole, even though the null shell has yet. So the event horizon is theological in the sense that it's determined by all the future events. Because we need to know all the way to square plus. So presumably we can form a black hole by collapsing the null shell. So imagine there's a null shell coming in from far away, collapsing in our direction. And if we could already be inside an event horizon, even though the null shell hasn't reached us yet. But because it could be at this point, the null shell is still coming in from far away. And then Yeah, in this sense, we could already be inside event horizon even now. Even though now she is still far away, it's still there to collapse in the time. So event horizon is theological in the sense that, in this precise sense, that you need to know what happens in the future. The entire future of the space-time in order to determine the exact notion of event horizon. Therefore, some people think that this could be problematic to work with in practice. And therefore, apparent horizon might be a better idea to work in level physics. But what apparent horizon is only determined by behavior of dipole. So instead of so there's no need to know the entire history of the space time. You only know the quasi local behavior of how the light rays behave. Essentially, it's a boundary between light rays that are directed upwards and moving upwards. So this is a normal light pole. That's this. Both directions have a theta, which is the expansion. It's upward. Let's say on the black hole horizon, at the boundary, the theta becomes zero. So this determines the apparent horizon. Now it has been suggested that event horizon does not truly exist, and one should work with apparent horizon instead. And if one considers apparent horizon instead of event horizon, it has been argued in the literature that this could help resolve the information loss paradox. The reason being, apparent horizon is a very dynamic concept. It evolves in time. And what was trapped behind apparent horizon at some point in time could become outside the apparent horizon at later time, and therefore escape the black hole. However, the apparent horizon is not without problem. The reason being, it's actually a hypersurface dependent concept. It depends on how you slice a space time. For example, for Schwarzschild black hole, there exists a slicing such that there is no apparent horizon at all if you use this kind of slicing. So it's not clear what is the physics of apparent horizon. It's hypersurface dependent. A better alternative similar to apparent horizon may be the so-called prism, which is proposed by Dr. Page, although not formally published in the paper. The concept of prism is such that for a fixed classical space-time, unlike the apparent horizon, is independent of the choice of slicing. It's defined as a set of all points through which there is a trap or imaginary trap surface. The concept of prism, however, is much harder to calculate than work with. So it's not clear how useful this concept is. Yeah. But for the purpose of this talk, it doesn't really matter. For a trap surface, it just means a apparent horizon. I think you could probably say that, I mean, if you consider the event horizon is a better concept in the sense that it does not depend on how you slice the space-time. So every observer can agree that there is an event horizon surrounding the black hole. Right? But the apparent horizon is not such a concept. there are observers that simply say that there is no such thing as a apparent horizon because you cannot see it. And so, yeah, it's in that sense very important. Right? It's a distinct notion, right? I mean, whether the space-time is complete or not, it's independent of whether an object is geological in nature. Yeah. For example, in the social space-time, if at least at the classical level, we have the singularity, and in that sense, it's not complete. And event horizon is geological, but there are also apparent horizon, and these are not theological concepts. So these two notions are quite distinct. So let's come to the information loss paradox. John Wheeler once asked, what happens if I drop my cup of tea black hole? Presumably information that falls into the black hole, like what makes up the tea, eventually disappear after the hot tea evaporations set in and the black hole disappeared. So this is a Penrose diagram for evaporation of a black hole. This is a star that collapses into a black hole. This is the singularity. And sigma 1 is some hypersurface where you have initial data describe on this hypersurface. And after the black hole has evaporated away, the late time has become dust because of space. And on sigma 2, if you compare sigma 2 with sigma 1, it seems that part of the informations, let's say those are contained here, has crashed into singularity and is now not available anymore on sigma 2. So there's some loss of information, at least. Right. Now we know that in quantum theory, information should never actually be lost, although it can be scrambled beyond repair. Unitarity should be preserved. So the big question is, where did the information go? How do we recover the information that falls into a black hole? Now, if you believe that information eventually comes out from a Hawking condition, the question is then, when does the information comes out? This is a so-called the Page curve, based on the work by Don Page. Now consider a formation of a black hole from a collapse of a metal, which is in pure state. Unitarity demands that at the end of the evolution, the pure state should remain pure. So we should be able to recover the pure state at the end. Now, this is time, and vertical axis is the entanglement entropy in the radiation, in the Hawking radiation. So at the very beginning, it's a pure state, and there's no Hawking radiation yet. So entanglement entropy in the radiation is simply zero. And by unitarity, we want it to be zero at the very end. And therefore, there is a turnover of this Page curve at the so-called Page time, which is roughly the half-life of the black hole. So before Page time, the black hole is called young. After that, it becomes old. For a young black hole, what happens is essentially, after the formation of the black hole, you have Hawking radiation coming up, and the entanglement entropy in the the radiation simply increases in time, and after a while, this entanglement entropy starts to decrease. So what happens around this point is that the late time Hawking radiation is now starting to purify the early time radiations, and at the end you recover zero. So that's how at least some people think how we can because a few years ago, Harry Maroff, who sits in the salary, wrote this famous paper on black hole firewall, essentially saying that there's some problem involved in the proposed solutions of how to get information out. So in their paper, they basically explain that the following assumptions are inconsistent. They cannot all be true. So what are the assumptions? The first one is the unitarity assumption. The quantum theory should be unitary. Hawking radiation should therefore contain information about the state that form black hole, which is what I mentioned just now. The second assumption is the result of general relativity, that there is no drama. What this means is that if the black hole is sufficiently large, such that the curvature is very small at the horizon, the unfolding observers, the free force of the black hole, does not encounter anything special because the curvature is just flat space time. Okay, so this is so-called no drama. And then the second assumption is the validity of the usual quantum field theory that we're using on the cold space time of a black hole. Particular that the information carried by the radiation is emitted from the region near the horizon with low energy effective field theory being valid. And so, in the next few slides, I will explain what is the firewall. But for now, let me point out that according to AMPNS, their solution is that since three of these are inconsistent, we should at least throw away one of them, modify one of them. And their claim is that the most conservative solution is that we should throw away number two. So if no drama is incorrect, as they wanted to claim, then observer that falls into the black hole will encounter something dramatic. And that drama is what they call firewall. So this is the picture of the usual event horizon. So before the observer just falls through without noticing anything strange. Now in the firewall picture, the evolving observer hits the event horizon and gets burned up at this firewall. So the observer never really passed through the black hole at all. Now the picture is the following. Now imagine that we have this is supposed to be the early time Hawking radiation. Okay? Hawking radiation that has been emitted in the earlier time. And then the late time Hawking evaporation, the late time Hawking particle is supposed to purify the earlier ones. Okay. So they argue that we need the late time Hawking particles to be maximally entangled with the early particles. However, the late time Hawking particles is also maximally entangled with its own Hawking pair that falls into the black hole, right? So there is a requirement that we need three systems to be maximum entangled, and this is not allowed by quantum information theory. Okay, so monogamy theorem that forbids such a maximum entanglement. You can only maximally entangle two systems instead of three. And therefore, the firewall proposal is that we should break the entanglement between these Hawking pairs across the horizon. And this results in a firewall. To be more precise, since there's no entanglement between the interior and the exterior, the field configuration horizon square other derivative field configuration. And if the field compression is not continuous, this term is going to go up. So you have given the energy density at where the event horizon should be, and that is what they call the fireball. Now this is the energy term, the in a sense it's not well defined. Well, since now they are breaking the entanglement between the interior and exterior, so there's no relation between the field configuration in the interior and the field configuration on the right. So generically, it is not guaranteed to be continuous, but the derivative is going to blow up. Right, it's quite exact. And the, and the reason they want to break this entanglement is that they want the late time clocking particle to purify the weather time, and thereby preserving unitarity. But in doing so, it creates this tension with relativity, because with relativity you should not sense anything at all, even or else. I go to the central issue at the top, which is the location of the firewall. If you ask this question, should it be? It's usually thought that the firewall should lie on the black hole event horizon, as I mentioned in the cartoon picture before. Now, of course, we know that in quantum mechanics, there are no sharp boundaries, and the position event horizon should be uncertain, perhaps up to fluctuation of the boundary, or fuzzy in quantum mechanics. So there are two possibilities. One possibility, which is already mentioned by ARPNS, is that firewall could be inside the event horizon, slightly inside. In such a case, because of the dynamic nature of the interior geometry, the firewall would fall into the singularity. But supposedly, a new firewall will be dynamically replenished, okay, over some time scale. But the point relevant to this talk is that if the firewall is inside the event horizon, then it is not visible from the outside. Now, there's another possibility. Suppose firewall is outside of the event horizon, then can you actually see from the outside without falling in and getting burned on the event horizon? Now, in this case, if it's only a Planck length away from the event horizon, then you expect that this is still well hidden inside the Planckian region of the very hot thermal atmosphere at the black hole. So, in either case, it should not be observed by exterior observers that does not fall into the black hole. Is there any question? Now, in our work, we make the causality assumption for firewalls. But as I want to stress, this is purely an assumption. We don't know whether this is true, but it seems quite reasonable to assume this. Now, a firewall, let me go back a few slides to remind you of the Pesch curve. Now, note that the entanglement entropy of the radiation only starts to reduce after some time, which is before the Pesch time. So, before that, we do not expect any firewall at all. The firewall only sets in after each time, when the purification process starts to happen, and when you need to break the entanglement between interior and exterior. So this only happens for old black hole, but not for the young ones. And therefore, the time where the firewall sets in depends. depends on the history of the evolution of the black hole evaporation. Right? We need to know what happens in the past and when it has become old. So we make the assumption that a firewall, if it indeed exists, has a location determined by the past history of the Hawking evaporating black hole. And the firewall should be near where the event horizon would be if the evaporation rate was smooth without counter fluctuation. Okay. So we have a black hole that's Hawking evaporating, and we know what is the evaporation rate by the formula that Hawking comes up with. And by that, we know the evolution or the position of event horizon. And that's where presumably the firewall would be. But as we pointed out afterwards, the quantum fluctuations will become important. Now this is a quick reminder of the thermal mass loss of a black hole. So the Hawking temperature is basically 1 over m with a bunch of various factors. A thermal mass loss is up to a gray body factor. This basically goes to the dmdt, is basically the area times temperature to the fourth. And this happens to be the 1 over m squared. So the lifetime of that hole is the order of m cubed. For a solar mass black hole, this is about 10 to the 67 years, very long, long time. So this is the mass loss formula that we'll be using. So in fact, in this paper, for simplicity or for convenience, we will use the Padilla metric, the negative energy influx, to reduce the mass of the black hole. This is how the method looks like. And then the mass loss rate is simply given by this alpha for some alpha is basically determined by the number and the species of the particles that emit the Hawking radiation. Now for simplicity, we can say photons and gravitons. So basically, m dot is minus alpha or m squared. And in the paper, we call this the adiabatic mass loss equation. Okay. Well, in the literature, it's often used to study evaporation of the black hole. Using the Padilla metric, the distinction between apparent horizon and event horizon is also much clearer. The apparent horizon is at r equals to 2m, which is now a function of f1's time v. The event horizon, on the other hand, has to determine by equation 1. So r dot is the rdv. This is basically 1/2 times this factor. So it's essentially on the boundary of those null geodesics that reach out to the future null infinity. You see, you're falling into the black hole singularity. And one could solve this to get the position on the event horizon. And if you define u and p in this way, and assume that n, which is minus d dot p over m, being a constant, then we could write out the series expansion for the position of the horizon. So essentially, in this form. Now, in our case, we assume adiabatic mass loss, and therefore our n is in fact equal to 2. And if you plug this into the previous formula here, then we can determine, we can write out the position of the event horizon up to some order of alpha over m. Okay. So as you can see, the event horizon is pretty close to m, which is the apparent horizon. It can be shown that the adiabatic mass loss would imply the second derivative of the cube of the mass is equal to zero. However, since the event horizon is very close to M, we also have this, approximately zero. So we define this adiabatic horizon, okay, this is our definition, by the outer solution to this equation. Outer solution, because there are actually two solutions. Right, so the adiabatic horizon is a value of R such that the second derivative of its cube is equal to zero. Okay. So it's in fact very close to where the event horizon would be. Right. So the logic here is going to be that if the mass loss is entirely adiabatic, then in fact the event horizon and adiabatic horizon would be pretty much very close together. However, what we're going to show next is that eventually we will show that if you consider quantum fluctuation, this would affect the event horizon in such a way that it will separate away from adiabatic horizon, so they are no longer as close to quantum fluctuation. Classically, they are more or less the same thing. So the reason here is that the event horizon, as I mentioned at the beginning of the talk, is theological, right? So it depends on the quantum fluctuation even in the future. So that can affect the event horizon, the position of the event horizon. But the adiabatic horizon, which is where the firewall is going to be on, assumes only the past behavior. Right? This is our causality assumption. So it does not depend on the future. So, in a more geometrical invariant way, one could also define a adiabatic horizon as basically the location where this gradient vector of the gradient vector of r squared minus 2mr is in the outward null direction. So in short, we could have an explicit form of the adiabatic horizon as opposed to this expression. Now note that m dot is a negative quantity, as a massive frequency. So the square root here has a 1 minus something. And it becomes not defined when this thing becomes negative. I'll mention a bit more about this and how it works. But the point is that as the adiabatic horizon and the event horizon, they are pretty much agree with each other before considering quantum fluctuation. To this order given, they are exactly the same. Now let us consider the quantum fluctuation. And first, the main idea. But the actual event horizon depends on the future evolution of the space-time. This is the theological property. And not just on that of its past. And therefore, quantum fluctuations in the future can lead the event horizon to deviate, perhaps significantly, from the adiabatic horizon. But it depends on how big the fluctuation is. If the mass loss rate exceeds the adiabatic formula, this will cause the event horizon to become inside the adiabatic horizon. So this is the Penrose diagram. I must stress that this is completely hand-drawn, the sense that this is not the result of the representation of the art. We have not simulated this detail. It's a work in progress. But this is what we expect to have. This is the green line is the event horizon, as usual. And this red line is a down shell of a horizon for the black hole. Now the apparent horizon is this red line over here. And the blue line is what the adiabatic horizon become if there's some kind of fluctuation that brings the event horizon inside the adiabatic one. Right? So the result is that the firewall could then become naked and visible from the future now. Right? So the blue line can become, in this case, outside the event horizon. Therefore, it can be perceived by observers outside. Now, some details to make this statement more precise. Now, we will consider the following. Suppose the unperturbed mass loss, this is before introducing the fluctuations, is simply M1. So it satisfies this formula. And this is the mass loss rate. The quantum fluctuations is M2. And then associated with this, there's a fluctuation also in the event horizon radius. Well, these are assumed to be small, such that we can ignore some of the terms. And therefore, the total mass is just M1 plus some terms involving R2 and R1. Now there's another assumption here, which is, again for simplicity, we assume that even with quantum fluctuations, we can still use the Fourier form of the metric, and geometry remains spherical symmetric. This is of course highly idealized, but perhaps good for first approximation. So, now consider some time V equals to V0. Let us ignore all the quantum fluctuations before this time, so there is no quantum fluctuations before V0, and therefore M2 is simply 0 before that. Now at time V equals to V0, we define a constant M0, which is just the total mass at V0, and because M2 is 0 at that point, it's the same as when M1 V0. Now if M0 is big enough, and the time between V and V0 is sufficiently small compared to the cube of this M0. The cube, because we call the lifetime of black holes, goes like the cube of the mass. Right. So, assuming this, the fractional decay of the black hole over the advanced time is small, and one could have R1s is approximately 2M1. And therefore, in short, we could solve what R2 is. R2 is the fluctuation in the event horizon. So R2 is explicitly given by this formula over here. It's just a linear, it's just a first order equation. R2, let's solve it this way. Now we have to assume some form of answer for this quantum fluctuation, some computation. And this is the formula that we use. So before V0, there is no quantum fluctuation, so we want this to be 0, therefore there is a step function here. And then there's basically two parameter, which is free. Now F will determine the magnitude of the quantum fluctuation, so this is how big the quantum fluctuation will be. Is how large the quantum fluctuation in the energy emission rate is relative to the adiabatic emission rate. Here we assume that F should be positive so that the fluctuation increases the emission rate above the adiabatic one. And then there is another parameter which is beta, EBITDA, it determines how fast the quantum fluctuation in the energy emission rate decays over an advanced time of 4m0. It should be n without the d, something like that. Now 4m0 is of course the inverse of the surface gravity of the black hole, but let's point it out. But anyway, this is just an answer for the combination. You should try with other forms of ANSAP and see how robust the result is, but those are also work in progress. Now, with our assumption that M2V is zero for V less than V0, we get the approximate solution of M2 in this form. And then we can solve for the R2, which is in this complicated form. However, minus R2 has a maximum value precisely when R2 is evaluated at V equals to V0. And this turns out to be approximately this value. So it's 2 beta over 1 plus beta multiplied by this factor over here, which again is governed by both F and beta. And this factor over here is precisely the same as M2 at V equals infinity. So this is the same formula from the previous slide. So that if beta is much larger than 1, then what this is saying is that R2V0 is approximately the same as 2. At infinity, twice the total mass fluctuation. However, for an order of magnitude relation, we will just assume that beta is of order 1, and therefore the solution goes. 2 is not quite important. Right. So, in fact, it turns out that the fluctuation in the radius of the event horizon at V equals V0 occurs before there is any decrease in the mass below the unperturbed value M1. So this is precisely the teleological property of the event horizon. Now, despite what I have mentioned just now, note that if alpha, beta, and f are all of order 1, then the inward shift of the event horizon is actually order 1 over m. This is a comma, not a prime. Right. So this translates to the following sentence, that the proper distance, if one calculates the proper distance from the firewall, that might be close to the adiabatic horizon, which is at R equals R1, to the event horizon, which is shifted by this R2, which is actually negative. Okay. So if you calculate the proper distance between the event horizon and the adiabatic horizon, you'll find that if alpha, beta, and F are all order 1, then this proper distance in a suitable frame, which is the frame of the timeline, the firewall surface outside the horizon, is of the order of the Planck length. Okay? So again, if this is order 1, then the distance between the event horizon and the firewall is just Planck length. Right? And in the introduction, we mentioned that for such a firewall, it should not be observable from the outside because it's hidden inside the very high energy local atmospheres near the black hole anyway. Right. So this paragraph basically says the same thing. The proper acceleration of any observer that stays some Planck length outside the event horizon would be of the order of the Planck acceleration. Okay? So this will give ample temperature experienced by this observer, or the order of the Planck temperature. So this would make the naked firewall in this case, fairly indistinguishable from a firewall which is inside or at the event horizon. So this is not enough to make a firewall truly naked, but F can be arbitrarily large because of free parameter. So presumably you can get the distance, the proper distance between the event horizon and that of the firewall to be sufficiently far away, yeah, sufficiently big. But there's a probability suppression as well. The bigger the fluctuation you need for such a big separation, the lower the probability. It's probably suppressed by an exponential Boltzmann factor for this graph form. So it's essentially exponential minus F over beta. Okay. The probability would not be zero, so there's a chance that there's a large fluctuation the grander the firewall naked, but it will be pretty much suppressed. But the black hole has a very long lifetime anyway, so there's a chance that we see this. But in fact, we don't need too large a fluctuation, we only need a sufficiently large but not too large, so that it's not too suppressed. For example, you work out that you consider a firewall which is only about 12 Planck units away from the event horizon, then the annual temperature seen by an observer skimming the firewall at this distance, the horizon, would be about 1 over 75 of the Planck temperature. Okay? So arguably, this should be low enough for the firewall to be naked. This calculation is not in the paper, it has not been properly checked, so I put this out just to make the point. I stress the main result here is that the putative firewall, if it is determined by the purely causal past behavior of the space time, and the location is sufficiently near where the event horizon would be under adiabatic emission thereafter, then quantum fluctuations at later time could move the actual event horizon inward, and this could happen even before these quantum fluctuations with the mass emission rate begin. So the event horizon becomes inside the location of the firewall, and thereby rendering it naked. So this is problematic because a naked firewall which is outside a black hole would be truly at odds with generative, especially if it's sufficiently far away. Now, not only observer that falls into the black hole gets incinerated and die, burning up at the firewall, but you could hit the firewall even before you fall into the black hole, so that's even more strange. Right? It could also affect the spectrum of the Hawking radiation, so that its presence can be inferred by astronomical observers. Conclusion is that the firewalls are not a conservative solution to the MPS paradox. Remember that in the firewall paper they have a few assumptions. Then they say the most conservative solution is to throw away no drama and thereby introducing the concept of firewall. So the point of this paper is to point out that that solution is not as conservative as they might think. And firewalls is more complicated and more problematic than what people really realize. Now, after we put our paper in the archive, Aidan Brown has sent us an email. He's the world leading expert on black hole mining. Let me quickly explain what is black hole mining. So suppose this is a black hole, then it evaporates according to a certain rate, like the adiabatic phase loss. The idea of mining is to make this evaporation goes faster than it would naturally be. So you mine the Hawking radiation. There are a couple of ways of doing this. One way is to insert strings in the black holes. Okay. So that what these are cosmic strings that start at the black hole surface, and it provides channels for Hawking radiation to come down, overcoming the effective potential near the black hole. Because of the effective potential near the black hole, not all Hawking particles emitted from the black hole can come up infinitely efficiently. So this provides the channels to overcome that, and therefore it could make the black hole radiation goes faster. In the context of the naked firewall, Brandon Brown suggested that one need not wait for the firewall to become naked by quantum fluctuation. We could actively disrupt the firewall by minute black hole. So in principle, this could cause event horizon to stream much further below the RWD horizon than it would be very probable with just quantum fluctuation. So if the mining works, it seems that with suitable form of mining, one could almost certainly make a firewall naked. But at this point, we don't have details of whether we can actually achieve this. Now, in the last few minutes of the talk, I will mention some other horizon estimates. I recall that our definition of the adiabatic horizon gives rise to such a formula. It has a disadvantage near the final evaporation phase. When M becomes sufficiently small, this no longer makes sense, it becomes complex, right? So this graph as a function of M just terminates when M becomes sufficiently small. But this alpha, I remind you, is the constant determined by the number of the species emitted by the radiation. However, there are other estimates for where the firewall can be, okay? With basically the same results that we can have naked firewall, but you use other horizon estimates. For example, Don Page has proposed the possibility of the following horizon. So this is the fourth root horizon defined in such a way, which is always real. The trick is just to come up with some estimates that match the first two terms of the event horizon. Then it will be a good estimate of where the event horizon will be without quantum fluctuations. And this is one possible horizon to work with. It's still the adiabatic one. So indeed, if you work with the four group horizon, and if one had a model in which a black hole evaporates in such a way that the event horizon will exactly be in the four group horizon, then by the definition of the event horizon, and if we define epsilon to be n alpha or m square, then m square m dot satisfies this property. Okay, this equation over here. And if m is very large, and so epsilon is very small, this is very close to 1. Okay. It then decreases, okay, as epsilon increases. So it starts pretty close to 1. It decreases and then increases again as epsilon goes infinity. So this is this S is epsilon, and this S is just this formula. So the point is that this guy is always of order 1. Okay. Right. It's always order 1. So this means that we always satisfy this mass loss rate m dot, which goes like roughly minus 1 of m square, is always maintained even as m goes to 0. So in short, this is the four root horizon is a good quantity to work with, and still satisfying the usual mass loss formula. Yeah. So that's all for my talk today. Thank you, and happy belated Chinese New Year. Yeah, you know that Chinese New Year the Chinese calendar in such a way that every year corresponds to a type of animal. And this year is the year of the monkey. But there's also five elements in Chinese culture, right? So essentially, it's a sexagesimal system. 12 times 5 is 60. So each animal, there's a five elements, right? So this year corresponds to a fire monkey. This will end the talk on firewall. Thank you. Yes. So they have gold, water, fire, and yeah, so wood and earth. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Honestly, I don't know. We've not talked about astrology. Yeah. Okay. Yes. Yes. Breakdown causality. No, it's not in that sense, right? I mean the teleological property is simply this is simply standard general relativity, right? It's not a new definition, it's the definition. It's basically the property of a event horizon as defined in general relativity. So the event horizon is determined. The event horizon basically, you need to know what can reach the future now in order to determine what is the event horizon. Essentially, it's defined by the notation of what can or cannot reach the now. Whatever is inside the black hole cannot reach that. But whatever is outside can reach that boundary. It's the event horizon. But in order to define that, you need to know what happens at the end of it. The horizon would adjust its positions. Anticipating the coming falling objects. So causality is preserved simply because GR is respect causality. So theological is not to be confused with causality. Very complicated. I mean, usually for black hole mergers, I think they work with apparent horizon instead of event horizon. I'm not completely sure how they work. but you could. Yeah. In principle, I think you can repeat the entire exercise for other theories, as long as you meet some black hole solution. As long as it has a suitable black hole solution, then you can define a suitable horizon. Yeah, we'll see.